न्यूट्रिशन। न्यूट्रिशन इज एन एसेंशियल कंपोनेंट इन द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ ऑल द डिजीज एंड डिसऑर्डर, नॉट ओनली इन द डिजीज इंडिविजुअल्स बट इवन इन द हेल्थी इंडिविजुअल। इट्स इम्पॉर्टेंस इज पैरामाउंट एज फार एज पीडियाट्रिक पॉपुलेशन इज कंसर्न। बिकॉज इन अवर प्रीवियस सेक्शन ऑन ग्रोथ वी लर्न दैट फर्स्ट ईयर ऑफ लाइफ दैट इज इन्फेंसी इज एंटायरली डिपेंडेंट ऑन न्यूट्रिशन फॉर इट्स ग्रोथ। So that is why we'll be discussing this aspect in a detailed manner. We'll be talking about starting from breast milk, and then we'll be talking about malnutrition, different type of micronutrient deficiencies and their management. So we'll start with breast milk. So breastfeeding, according to WHO, recommendation is for first 6 months baby should be on exclusive breastfeeding. In Western world, most of the countries, they start weaning by 4 months. But for most of the developing nations, WHO recommendations still insist on 6 months. Now, what are the different types of breast milk? I mean, there are different phases in which breast milk comes, and we'll be discussing about the salient features of each one of them. Colostrum, also known as first milk, and in certain populations, it is a taboo that you should not give first milk, and they call it sometime a witch's milk, which is a real bad practice, because colostrum is the one which is most beneficial and effective in preventing all the infections, as it contains a very high amount of immunoglobulin and protein. It is rich in antibodies and it is rich in fat soluble vitamins, which are A, D, E, K. So colostrum is basically the milk which comes for first 3 to 4 days. Very important. First 3 to 4 days. After colostrum comes the transitional milk. So transitional milk lasts from first 3 to 4 days to, sorry, after 3 to 4 days to 14 days. Now, what is the difference between transitional milk and colostrum? Amount of immunoglobulin and protein slightly decreases, and fat and sugar content, it increases, right? So transitional milk is followed by mature milk. This mature milk, which comes usually after 2 weeks, it is much thinner as compared to their earlier counterparts. That is almost watery, and it contains all essential nutrients. Right? So these are the different stages in which breast milk changes in its consistency to fulfill the needs of a growing infant. Now, there are few more terminologies which we need to understand as far as breastfeeding is concerned. First is preterm milk. If the baby is born prematurely, obviously he is going to be low birth weight, or maybe in extreme cases very low birth weight or extremely low birth weight. So his requirement will be slightly different as compared to a term baby. So body Mother's body adjusts itself very nicely to fulfill their requirement by changing the consistency of breast milk. So preterm milk is slightly different from a term milk in a way that it contains more proteins, because obviously preterm baby needs to catch up. So preterm milk contains more proteins as compared to term milk. It contains more sodium, it contains more iron, and it contains more immunoglobulins. So these are the difference between preterm. Rest of the composition is exactly same, but it is rich in protein, sodium, iron, and immunoglobulins, so as to provide extra protection, as immunity of a preterm baby is even less as compared to a term baby. And since weight is really less, preterm baby needs more protein to build a catch-up growth. Now there are few more terms as far as amount and the stages of breastfeeding is concerned. So when a mother is breastfeeding his baby, as soon as she starts breastfeeding the baby, there are different stages, right? So the first milk which comes after, once as soon as mother initiates the breast milk breastfeeding, is called foremilk. Very important. So foremilk is watery, but it is rich in protein, sugar, water, minerals, and vitamins. So foremilk, since it is watery, it quenches the thirst of the baby. Very important. So it primarily fulfills or quenches the thirst of the baby. The milk which comes later on during a single episode of breastfeeding is called hind milk. Hind milk is much thicker and it is rich in fat and energy. So it satisfies baby's hunger. Very important. So foremilk is for satisfying baby's thirst and hind milk is for satisfying baby's hunger. And that is why it is really essential to counsel the mother that whenever she is breastfeeding the baby, it is really important to empty the entire breast. For example, if mother is, let's say, just giving the foremilk, it might be satisfying baby's thirst, but baby's hunger won't be satisfied. Plus, the amount of fat and energy is mainly there in hind milk. So if the baby is not getting the hind milk, the weight gain won't be satisfactory. And we also tell mothers to empty both the breasts, not only the single breast, so as to provide maximum benefit to the growing infant, right? So with this background in mind, we'll move on to the technique of breastfeeding. Technique of breastfeeding. So there are two terminologies which you need to understand really, really well. And this, you, even as an MBBS final year student, this is the favorite question of most of the internal and external examiners. They always ask this question, that what do you mean by positioning? What are the essential components of positioning? And what do you mean by attachment? And what are the essential components of a good attachment? Okay. So first we'll be talking about positioning. So positioning means the whole body of the infant should be well supported and not only the back. This is first point. Whole body should be supported, not only the back, right? Second point, head and neck should be in the same line. Should be in the same line without any twist in the neck. This is very important, because if neck is twisted or if head and neck are not in the straight line, baby won't be able to swallow effectively. Baby's body should be turned towards the mother. Body should be turned towards the mother in such a way that mother's abdomen is touching with baby's abdomen. Mother's abdomen should be touching with baby's abdomen. Fourth point, baby's nose should be at the level of nipple. Baby's nose at the level of the nipple. So let's see and try to understand all these four points with the help of an image. So this is how an ideal positioning looks like. As you can clearly see here, mother elbow is supporting the whole body and not only the back. In this pic, it is however slightly difficult to appreciate, but head and neck are usually in the same line and there is no twist in the neck. As you can clearly see that the baby's body is turned towards the mother's body, right? And nose is almost at the level of nipple. So these are the signs of a good positioning. Now, for positioning, there is no fixed way. Mother can breastfeed the baby in any position she likes as far as she is fulfilling all those four criteria. So in next week we'll see what are the different kind of positioning which mother can have while feeding the baby. So these are the different positions which mother can acquire while breastfeeding the baby. So baby can be in standing position, sitting position, this is out of hand, knee position, in cases of twins this is the position, on the pillow, by using a sling, by using a cradle, or even maybe lying down. Sometime immediately after the delivery, let's say mother is having any complication and she might not be able to sit up properly, even then she can breastfeed the baby in even lying down position. But the essential component remains same. The whole body should be supported and not only the back. Baby's abdomen should be touching the mother's abdomen. Baby's nose should be at the level of nipple. There should not be any twist in the neck, and head and neck should be in the same line. So as far as all those four criteria are being fulfilled, it doesn't matter. It depends entirely on the mother's comfort level, what position she like to choose while feeding the baby, right? So now we move on to the next component of technique called attachment. Again, it is very, very important to learn what are the components of a good attachment. Even as an MBBS student, you should be knowing this by your heart. So the four essential components of a good attachment is: baby's mouth should be wide open. Most of the areola and nipple in the mouth. Only upper areola, this is very important, only upper areola visible, not the lower one. This point is really important. Third, baby's chin should be touching the breast. And lower lip should be everted. Baby's lower lip should be everted. So these are the four components of a good attachment. Let's try to understand this with the help of a picture. So this is a picture depicting a good attachment. So as you can clearly see, baby mouth is widely open. Most of the areola and the nipple is in the mouth, and only this upper areola is visible, not the lower one, as it is inside the mouth. You can easily appreciate that baby chin is touching the breast, and you can easily appreciate that lower lip is everted. So these are all signs of a good attachment, right? Now we'll see another diagram comparing the differences between a good attachment and a bad attachment. So in this pic, there is a comparison of between a good attachment and a poor attachment. So in the second pic, you can clearly see the entire areola is visible. Baby chin is not touching with the breast. Lower lip is hardly everted, right? So these all are signs of a bad attachment, right? And even the baby's mouth is not wide open like it is here. So this is bad attachment or poor attachment. If attachment is not proper, baby won't be able to breastfeed properly, and weight gain won't be satisfactory, and he won't be getting all the advantages of a breast milk, right? So it is very important to understand these two aspects of breastfeeding, that is positioning and attachment. With this background in mind, we'll move on to the components of a breast milk. So what are the components of a breast milk? Component of breast milk. So this part is slightly overlapping. Probably you must have read, or maybe you will read this in your PSN classes also. But I'm just focusing on those points and components which are more important from the clinical point of view. So breast milk contains 4.2 gram of fat. It contains 1.1 gram of protein. This is per 100 ml. 65 to 67 kilocalories, 7 gram of lactose. So, and apart from that, it contains a lot of protective elements in the form of IgA, other immunoglobulins, PABA, very important. PABA is a special biochemical which protects against malaria. Bifidus factor. Which protects against E. coli. Lactoferrin. Again, protects against E. coli. It also contains bile salt lipase, which protects against Giardia. Then it contains galacto oligosaccharide, which promotes myelin formation and hence promotes in maturation of central nervous system. Promotes myelin growth. It contains DHA, which is decosa hexa amino acid, this has been found to be very essential for brain growth. Right? Also, it contains cysteine and lysine, which are the amino acids essential for brain growth. Essential for brain growth. So it is very clearly evident why breast milk is crucial for a growing infant, and that's why WHO recommends that baby should be on exclusive breastfeeding for first 6 months of life, as it contains not only all the essential nutrients but as well as protective factor which baby will be needing at least for first 6 months of his life. Now, how do we say that breast milk which the baby is getting is adequate or not? So there are certain parameters which depicts the adequacy of breastfeeding, and what are they? So how to check the adequacy of breastfeeding? So the most sensitive indicator of adequacy of breastfeeding is weight gain. Very important. So if baby is not gaining weight appropriately, it means feeding is not adequate, as simple as that. There are other criteria. Baby should be sleeping well in between the feeds. Third, urine output. This is again a very important indirect criteria for assessing the adequacy of breastfeeding. If urine output, ideally, if the breastfeeding is adequate, baby should be passing at least 6 to 8 times urine in 24 hours. So these are the three criteria which will tell you, okay, breastfeeding is adequate or not. If any of this is absent, then you should, reevaluate, go back to your basics, whether the technique is appropriate, whether there is a defect in the attachment, whether there is a defect in the positioning, and sometimes there might be defect in mother's lactation. Probably mother might not be getting adequate lactation, maybe mother's nipples are malformed, and so on. But if all these three factors are there, then you can be reassured, okay, baby is getting enough amount of breast milk and there is no need of worry. Now lastly, EBM storage. Sometimes in extreme preterm babies, like we already discussed, if the baby gestation is less than 32 weeks, we cannot give breastfeeding directly. Breastfeeding can be safely given to the babies beyond 34 weeks of gestation. So in those cases, what do we do? We still breast milk is having all those protective factors, even though the baby is unable to take breastfeeding directly. Still, the recommendation is you give the breast milk in the form of expressed breast milk. Expressed breast milk. So this expressed breast milk needs to be stored also. Sometimes baby is not hemodynamically stable enough to take all the breast milk which mother is producing. So in that case, we usually recommend to store the breast milk so that it can be used later on. Now, how to store this expressed breast milk? If you are keeping at room temperature, you can easily store the EBM for 6 to 8 hours, right? If you are using a refrigerator, just the normal refrigerator, you can stay with up to the 6 to 8 hours. Oh, sorry, you can save it up to 24 hours. And if you are using a special refrigerator, that is free deep freezer, which can maintain easily up to a temperature of minus 20 degree, then you can easily save EBM up to 3 months. Right? And nowadays, there are even breast milk banks, and this is the latest concept which is becoming very popular. If because of some reason, if mother is not getting adequate breast milk, you can always take the breast milk from a breast milk bank, and where we can easily store EBM up to 3 months, right? And as far as contraindication of breastfeeding is concerned, there are hardly any. So first is HIV. Now this is very interesting. Chances of vertical transmission from mother to baby is up to 30% if mother opts for breast milk, breastfeeding. If mother is using ART, as well as if we are giving antiretroviral prophylaxis to the baby in the form of nevirapine, these chances reduces significantly. If mother is also on ART and if we are giving nevirapine for babies, the chances of transmission reduces drastically. Now in Western world, the recommendation is straightforward: don't give the breastfeeding. But in our scenario, like in most of the developing countries, the breast milk, the advantages of breastfeeding is more as compared to its risk. So if you don't give the baby breast milk, he will die of other infections and other complications. That's why in developing world, still WHO recommends breastfeeding, even in HIV. If mother decides not to give breast milk, then it is entirely her choice. But mixed feeding, this is very important. Mixed feeding is contraindicated. So either you have to give breast milk or you have to give top feed. You cannot do both, right? So that's why HIV might be a relative contraindication. If mother decides to not give breast milk to prevent this theoretical risk of vertical transmission, she can do that. But mixed feeding is absolutely contraindicated. Other contraindications are Hep B and Hep C. And if mother is on antipsychotic drugs like lithium. So these are very few of the absolute contraindication of breastfeeding. Otherwise, we have already understood how beneficial it is for baby, not only for its growth, but also for protection against different kind of diseases. Now we'll move on to the next topic, malnutrition. Malnutrition. So malnutrition is exactly opposite of nutrition. So it is basically inadequate consumption. So either consumption is less or inadequate, or maybe absorption is reduced. So that is malabsorption, or maybe excessive loss of nutrients. So these are the three mechanisms. Either the baby is getting less nutrients, or he is getting proper nutrient, but it is not getting absorbed, or baby is losing excess of the nutrients. All three will lead to eventually the decreased amount of nutrition leading to malnutrition. Right? Now there are some definitions which you need to remember, and these are very important from the examination point of view. And even as a clinician, if you are sitting in OPD or even if you are seeing inpatient, you have to monitor, you have to assess the growth and development and the nutritional status of a child. So all these definitions are really handy for making a proper diagnosis. So first term is wasting. Wasting means decreased weight for height. And not weight for age. Remember, this is very important. Weight is a most sensitive indicator. It is a most sensitive indicator for malnutrition. And it is the first to get effect as soon as the child is ill or is showing any faltering in growth. First thing to happen would be weight loss. And that is a presenting complaint to the OPD or maybe IPDs. The child is not gaining adequate weight. Mother will keep on complaining, okay, I came in the last visit like 3 months back, his weight was 8 kilo. Now after 3 months, again it is 8 kilos, right? So it is the most sensitive indicator. But remember, for wasting, we compare weight with the height. Let's say the height of the child is very small. Obviously, the taller individuals are heavier. This is a simple basic fact. So if the height is less, weight is going to be less. So that's why for labeling any child to be wasted, we have to compare weight for its corresponding height and not for the age. Right? Next term is stunting. Stunting means decrease height for age. Now, height is we are comparing with the age. And basically, it is more or less an indicator of chronic malnutrition. And weight basically tells you about acute malnutrition. Well, baby all of a sudden won't lose the height. Height gain is a gradual process which happens over a period of time. So if decreased height for age denotes something which is ongoing for a very long time. And that's why it is more or less an indicator of chronic malnutrition. While weight loss can happen even immediately after an acute diarrheal episode, let's say baby developed an acute episode of diarrhea and he lost a large amount of fluids and he landed in severe dehydration. Then he can have an acute weight loss and followed by decrease in weight for his height. So it is an indicator of some acute process, while height is a chronic process. Now, WHO, there is a WHO classification for differentiating malnutrition into different kinds of different grades of severity. So let's see what WHO says. So there are two terminologies in WHO classification. One is moderate malnutrition and other is severe. So these two criteria will take into account which we have just discussed. That is, first is weight for height, which is wasting. And second is height for age, which is stunting. And there is another component, edema. So let's talk about weight for height first. If weight for height is between minus 2 to minus 3 standard deviation, WHO label it as moderate malnutrition. If it is less than minus 3 standard deviation, it is severe malnutrition. But in case of height for age, again it is same minus 2 to minus 3 here, and it is less than minus 3 here. In severe, edema will be present, and in moderate there won't be any edema. So that's how WHO classify malnutrition. And this standard deviation, there is one catch here. For weight for height, moderate corresponds to 71 to 79%, and severe corresponds to less than 70% of the median. But in case of height, moderate means 86 to 89%, and severe means less than 85% of the median. So let us go through it again. It means normal, if the child is not malnourished, weight for height should be, so what are the normal values? So weight for height should be at least greater than 80% of the median. Then child is normal, is not wasted. In moderate, it is 71 to 79%. And in severe, it is less than 70%. Very important. Similarly, for height for age. Height for age, because height, you know, it is a long process like I just mentioned. So it can, for height for age to be labeled as normal, it has to be greater than 90% of the median. If it is between 86 to 89%, then it is moderate stunting. If it is less than 85%, it is severe stunting. Right? So this is very important in understanding, because in our clinical practice, we always use this criteria, weight for height and height for age, and label the child to be having as a moderate malnutrition or severe malnutrition, and then accordingly the management differs. Now for labeling this between minus 2 to minus 3 standard deviation or less than 3 standard deviation, we have to understand the WHO growth chart. So let me talk briefly about WHO growth charts, because all this classification of moderate to severe is happening on the basis of a WHO growth chart. So WHO growth charts were devised in year 2006 for children less than 5 years of age, and they are the most popular ones which are widely used worldwide, because they were devised on the basis of a multicentric study. And the samples were taken from 6 countries. 6 different countries. Samples taken from 6 different countries. India. And India samples were taken from Delhi, Oman, Norway, USA, Brazil and Ghana. Right? So like exhausting number of samples were taken from these 6 countries, and then they devised the normal centile values. And whenever we plot or assess any patient for height and weight, we take the reference as a WHO chart. So it contains basically different centile lines, the important ones were are, this is 3rd, 25th, 50th and 95th. So go back to the previous slide, I was telling you that for weight for height, it has to be greater than 80% of the median. So this 50th centile is taken as a median. So if it is at least 80% weight for height, it is considered to be as a normal. And similarly for height for age, if it is at least 90th centile or 90th percent of this median, then it is taken to be as a normal. And we have already defined that if it is between 86 to 89, it is moderate stunting. If it is less than 85, it is severe stunting. And for weight for height, it is 71 to 79 for moderate and less than 70 for severe. Presence of edema itself make it under severe malnutrition category. Okay. Then there is another classification which is very popular in India, and now most of the practitioners are using this one. It's called IAP classification, Indian Academy of Pediatric Classification. The drawback of this classification is it is not taking consideration the fact of height. It is just comparing weight for age, and that's why WHO one is still better. Weight for age. So according to IAP classification, there are 4 grades: grade 1, grade 2, grade 3 and grade 4. Cut karna hai, decline shayad dobara bol yahan se IAP classification se dobara bol diya, because taller individuals are going to be having much taller individuals are much heavier and shorter individuals are less heavier. So if you are taking age as alone as a consideration, the assessment won't be accurate enough. So according to IAP classification, there used to be like four grades, grade 1, 2, 3 and 4. So normal was greater than 80% of the median, 71 to 79 grade 1, 61 to 70 grade 2, 51 to 60 grade 3 and less than 50 grade 4. So this is mild, moderate, severe and very severe, right? So this is just now of historic importance. We always take we always measure weight for height and not weight for age. Now there are certain indices which are age independent, age independent indices. These are very important because it will in most of the developing countries, sometimes even they are not sure of their date of birth. So you don't know what is the exact age of the child. So that's where these criteria comes really handy. And while we were discussing growth and development, I already mentioned about mid-arm circumference, which is an age, mid-upper arm circumference, MUAC. We already discussed about Shaki's test, Shaki's tape and Bangle test. So this is an age-independent criteria. And other age-independent criteria which we already discussed was skin fold thickness, which is measured by Harpenden calimeter. So these two we already discussed. There are certain other indices which are age-independent, and you need to remember those names because sometimes they can ask directly in MCQ which of the following is not an age independent criteria, or sometimes they will ask, okay, which of the following is an age independent criteria. So if you know all the age independent criteria, you will be easily able to solve those MCQs. So next is Kanavati index. Kanavati index is a ratio of mid-arm circumference to head circumference. If this mid-arm circumference to head circumference ratio, if it is 0.32 to 0.33, it is considered to be a normal. If it is larger, lesser than that, it is abnormal, because we have clearly seen that head circumference in asymmetric IUGR, if there is sparing of head size, so head will be larger in size, and same thing happens in malnutrition also because there is relatively sparing of brain. So mid-arm circumference would be lesser as compared to head circumference, and that's why this ratio will be lesser. So this is the normal value of Kanavati index. The other indices are, just remember their name, Rao and Singh's index, Jugdale's index, Quack stick and jellyfish ratio. Jellyfish ratios also we discussed briefly while we were discussing growth and development. It is a ratio of head circumference to chest circumference, and we know that head circumference becomes equal to chest circumference at 3 years of life, and after that chest circumference takes over. So if this ratio, if it is greater than 1, then it indicates malnutrition, right? Because maximum allowed limit of head circumference is chest circumference plus 3 centimeter. If it is greater than 3, this sum, then it indicates hydrocephalus, right? Now we'll come to moderate and severe malnutrition. What are the features? And there are two primary conditions which are really important, not only for the entrance examination point of view, but again for your final MBBS exam, because this is the least examiners will expect from you, that if it comes to malnutrition, you should be at least knowing about kwashiorkor and marasmus, which I am going to discuss now. So these two are the conditions which are, you know, prototype of severe malnutrition. One is marasmus, other is kwashiorkor. Basically, the first important difference is, it is marasmus is mainly energy malnutrition. And this is protein plus energy malnutrition. Right? Secondly, edema. Marasmus doesn't have edema, while it is a pathognomic feature of kwashiorkor. Hepatomegaly is not seen in marasmus, it is seen in kwashiorkor. Appetite, very important differentiating factor, it is voracious in marasmus, it is depressed or reduced in kwashiorkor. Infections, they are less prone. Why they are less prone? Because as I mentioned earlier, it is primarily an energy malnutrition. So protein are still there, and all the immunoglobulins, they are protein in nature. So that's why their immunity is better as compared to kwashiorkor. And since it is both protein plus energy malnutrition, the immunoglobulin content would be less also, and hence they are more prone to infection, right? And activity, they are usually active and they are very lethargic. When it comes to prognosis, its prognosis is better and it is having a poor prognosis. Now, let's focus on some of the common clinical features which is seen in kwashiorkor and marasmus. We have already discussed the differences between them. Now, let's discuss the clinical feature. So, in marasmus, the child is grossly emaciated. So, there is a term which we use, skin and bone. You can literally count each and every bone of the boy, of the child. So it grossly emaciated. So this gross emaciations give rise to monkey faces. Monkey faces. Because of loose skin folds in buttocks, there's another fancy term which we use, baggy pant appearance. Well, those of you who understand or have some degree of fashion sense in early 90s, this kind of pants or trousers were really popular because they used to be very loose from the buttock area, and this, because of this loose skin folds in buttocks, it will give rise to exactly a baggy band appearance, very loose from the buttock, because there is no subcutaneous fat and hence there will be lot of skin folds giving rise to baggy band appearance. Rest of the features we have already discussed in table. So these are the two peculiar terms which we use to describe marasmus. Now let's move on to the kwashiorkor. So the overall appearance is described classically by another fancy term, sugar baby appearance. There's another fancy term called flaky paint appearance. Flaky paint appearance means, let's say if you have done whitewash in your home a long time back, then there will be a lot of walls where the paints will start coming out. And that kind of appearance is known as flaky paint appearance. It will appear like the paint is coming off of a wall. That is, skin will be cracked here and there. So this is called flaky paint appearance. There's another peculiar feature called flag sign. It is seen in hairs and there will be alternate areas of normal pigmented hair with hypopigmented. So it will give rise to a flag kind of appearance. That is, in the same hair, there will be an area where the pigment content is normal, followed by an area where the pigment content is really low. So these are the classical signs of Kwashiorkor coat and marasmus. Let's have a look at their pictures so that it will be easier for you to visualize and understand them. So this is a picture comparing both Kwashiorkor and marasmus simultaneously, and you'll be able to appreciate all those clinical features which we have just discussed. So this, on the left side, there's a child having Kwashiorkor, and on the right side there's a child having marasmus. As you can see, easily appreciate the skin and bone appearance. And this emaciated appearance is called monkey faces. Those baggy pant appearance is not visible because this pic is taken from the front. But if you will closely see the buttocks, you can easily appreciate that baggy pant appearance. There is decrease in subcutaneous fat. That's why it is leading to all those clinical manifestations. There is loosening of skin here in the thigh region. On the other hand, Kwashiorkor, this belly is protuberant and there is hepatomegaly, which of course you can't appreciate in the pic, but there is hepatomegaly with protuberant abdomen. There is xerosis, itchy rash, and this whole appearance will give rise to flaky paint dermatosis. Wound healing is poor because, again, as I told you, it is protein and as well as energy malnutrition, so they are more prone to infection, and hence wound healing is very poor as compared to marasmus. Right? Let's see another pic in which you'll be able to appreciate the flag sign and flaky paint dermatosis. See, this exactly resembles like the broken or the coming off paint from a wall. This is called flaky paint dermatosis. Right? Now I'll show you another pic demonstrating depicting flag sign. So this is flag sign. As you can clearly see, this a band of hypopigmented region. And this is normal pigmented hair. This is again normal pigmented hair. And hence the name called flag sign. There is alternate area of normal pigmented hair and hypopigmented hair. So this finishes malnutrition. Now we move on to a subcategory or very severe kind of malnutrition called as SAM. Now we'll move on to severe acute malnutrition. SAM. It is a most severe degree or malnutrition, and you will realize subsequently that the management is very different from other mild to moderate degree of malnutrition. So first of all, how do we define SAM? So the criteria for labeling any child to be having severe acute malnutrition is weight for height less than 3 minus 3 standard deviation, gross visible severe wasting, mid-arm circumference less than 11 centimeter with or without edema. Right? So these two criteria, weight for height less than standard deviation and mid-arm circumference less than 11.5 centimeter are essential. So that's why we always write weight for height less than 3 standard deviation and mid-arm circumference less than 11.5 centimeter with or without gross visible wasting or edema. This is the definition of SAM or severe acute malnutrition. Now its management is quite exhaustive and is divided into many steps. So there are 10 steps, just for the sake of simplification, 10 steps, 2 phases, and 6 weeks. Right? And it is a very, alarming complication or alarming thing which is really rampant in African, sub-Saharan Africa, and many Asian countries, including many areas of India. So, first week, we treat the complications. Then in second week, we add micronutrients. So these two phases, these two steps includes the phase of stabilization, which is first phase. Now in second phase, we do rehabilitation. Rehabilitation, and this phase lasts from 2 to 6 weeks. So these are the two phases, and there are total 10 steps. We'll be discussing about those 10 steps in our subsequent session. Now, in first come to the first step, that is the complication. So in first phase, like I just told you, we are in the stabilization phase. We are treating the complications and adding micronutrients. So what are the complications of SAM? Very, very important. Complications of SAM. So there is a mnemonic which will help you in easily remembering all those complications, and it is called SHIELDED. SHIELDED. S stands for sugar, that is hypoglycemia. Now there is another catch. While we were discussing in our neonatology sections, I explained you that the definition of hypoglycemia is taken as less than 40 milligram percent in RBC in whole blood and less than 45 milligram percent in plasma. But in SAM, we define hypoglycemia as less than 54 milligram percent. Very important. So our threshold of defining hypoglycemia is lower. So even at 54 milligram percent, we are labeling it as hypoglycemia. While in otherwise normal children, we won't label it as hypoglycemia unless the blood sugar falls below 40 or 45 milligram percent. Next complication is hypothermia. So this is The acronym SHIELDED, hypothermia. And we already discussed how hypoglycemia and hypothermia always goes hand in hand. And because there is no subcutaneous fat, no subcutaneous tissue, the heat loss will be severe, and that's why they are very prone to hypothermia. I stands for infections. Right? So we always, even if they are not having any clinical signs and symptoms suggestive of infection, we still assume that they are having the infection, and that's why you always start on first line antibiotics in the form of ampicillin and gentamicin. Right? Now, EL stands for electrolyte disturbance. This is one of the most threatening complications of SAM, because they are always hypernatremic and always hypokalemic. And that's why you need to be really cautious in starting IV fluid. In fact, we never start on IV fluid in SAM unless the patient is in shock. Very important, because they are already hypernatremic and they are already hypokalemic. If you are giving IV boluses like other patients, then you are further increasing the sodium and fluid overload, and they will go into heart failure, right? Hypokalemia is treating by oral potassium supplements. We never go for IV unless it is leading to arrhythmias. DE stands for dehydration. And this is one of the most common, frequently seen complication, because most of the SAM children will be presenting as acute gastroenteritis, and invariably they are dehydrated. Right? So we have to correct dehydration very cautiously, and dehydration correction in SAM is very different as compared to dehydration correction in otherwise normal children having gastroenteritis. So dehydration, because of the same reason that they are already having hypernatremia and hypokalemia, they are more prone to land up in having fluid overload. So fluid overload, remember, is the most common cause of death. Most common cause of death in SAM. So dehydration correction, unless the patient is in shock, is always by using ORS, that is oral rehydrating solution, and it is more prolonged. So dehydration correction in SAM is usually done over 12 hours as compared to 3 to 6 hours in otherwise normal children. Otherwise normal children. Reason exactly same, that you don't want to land up them in fluid overload. Now last, D stands for micronutrient deficiency. Micronutrient deficiency. So they are deficient in vitamin A, vitamin K, iron, folic acid, magnesium, zinc, and calcium. So let's go back to the previous slide. I told you that in first phase, that is stabilization phase, we also add micronutrients within first week. There is one exception, iron. So iron is an exception. Iron supplementation we start by second week, not in first week. Rest of the micronutrient deficiency we can start in first week. So these were all the complications associated with SAM. Now let's come to the 10 steps which I was talking about. So the 10 steps, first was, so this extreme left hand side steps, these are two phases and this is number of days. So day 1 to 2, day 3 to 7, these include first phase, that is stabilization, and then 2 to 6 weeks, it includes rehabilitation. So this is second phase. So we divide like this. First phase is further divided into first 2 days and day 3 to 7, and second phase is lasting from 2 to 6 weeks. So first step was correct hypoglycemia. These are all complications which we have just discussed. Hypothermia, remember, shielded, dehydration, infection, electrolytes disturbance, electrolytes disturbance, micronutrients. So these were all complications. So we have to address all of them by within first week. So hypothermia and hypoglycemia are the immediate complications and they can be life-threatening. So within first 2 days you need to correct them. Same goes for dehydration, it can be life-threatening, so you have to correct within first 2 days. And infection, again, it can be life-threatening, so you start immediately and continue for entire first week. And I already told you, you assume that they all are infected irrespective of the signs and symptoms, and you start them on first line antibiotics for first 7 days of life. Now electrolyte disturbance, again, they are immediate and they can be again life-threatening within first week of life. So you start correcting them immediately and their correction keeps on, even it continues even during the rehabilitation phase, because this hypernatremic and hypokalemic state is not going to resolve overnight. So usually it takes time. Micronutrient deficiency, again, you start immediately and continue throughout. Exception, I told you, iron. So iron is added here at the starting of second week. Rest of the micronutrients you are already starting right from the day one. So these first steps were addressing directly the complications of SAM which we had just discussed. Now the rest of the four steps are more or less related to the rehabilitation phase, and which includes initiate feeding, catch up growth, sensory stimulation, and prepare for follow up. So feeding, depending upon the hemodynamic condition, if the child is otherwise hemodynamically stable, you have to start immediately, like right from the day one. And of course you can't stop the feeding, so you just keep on continuing it at least for 7 days of life, and then later on, as soon as the child is stable, you can shift the child to normal family pot. Right? Catch up growth, again, it is a thing of second phase, so it's starting here, not from here. And same thing goes for sensory stimulation. Now sensory stimulation is also very important for children having severe acute malnutrition. Because of severe deficiency of micronutrients, their sensory stimuli, their sensory perception is already very reduced. So you need to stimulate it right from the beginning. So it is again starting here and it's continuing throughout. Preparing for follow-up, of course, it will come under rehabilitation phase, so it is starting here. So these are the 10 steps divided into two phases and divided into three time intervals in management of SAM. Remember, this is very, very important to remember these phases, particularly the complications, because it has been asked in various entrance examination time and again. Now, feeding. I told you initiate feeding is a thing which will start right at day one if there are no life-threatening complication. So for initiating feeding also, there is a mnemonic. Like shielded was a mnemonic for remembering the complication. So initiation of feeding also you can remember by a mnemonic called BEST. This is how you start the feeding and progress the feeding. So B stands for begin feeding. E stands for make it more energy dense gradually. And sensory stimulation, which we have already discussed, we are starting right from the beginning. And it also involves tender love and care. So we'll begin feeding in small amount and then gradually make it more energy dense, because their tolerance is also low. If you make the feeding energy dense right from the beginning, they won't be able to tolerate it. Now, what kind of feed should we give in SAM? Well, because they are GI mucosa is, you know, grossly immature and shredded, we can't, you know, give them feeding like a normal child. So there is some two special type of diet or feed which is available in SAM children. And what are they? It's called F75 and F100. So 75 stands for 75 kilocalorie per 100 ml and F100 stands for 100 kilocalorie per 100 ml. So how do we start the feeding? Let's say child is hemodynamically stable. You have started the child on IV antibiotics. You have started the child on all micronutrient supplementation except iron. You have ensured that there is no hypoglycemia. You have ensured that child is euthermic, that is, there is no hypothermia. Now it's the time to start feeding. So initially you start the child on F75. The amount would be 130 ml per kg. So this will be the total amount, right? So initially what you are going to do, you will divide this whole amount in two hourly intervals. Let's say for the sake of simplification, if I assume that the weight of the child is 5 kilos, so the total amount would be 650 ml, right? Then you will divide into 12 aliquots. Every 2 hourly means there will be 12 aliquots. So roughly the amount will come around 55 ml every 2 hourly. If the child is tolerating at least 80% of this amount without any feed intolerance, you will shift the child to 3 hourly intervals. Now there is catch here. Amount will remain same. You won't increase the amount from 130 ml per kg to 140 or 150. You will just decrease the frequency. Now the same amount of 650 ml you will start giving in 3 hourly intervals. So now there will be total 8 feeds. Again, if the same criteria is fulfilling, that is, if the child is tolerating 80% of those 3 hourly feeds without any feed intolerance, you will make the child, will shift the child to 4 hourly intervals. And if the child is tolerating even the same amount, now the total feeds will become 6. If the child is tolerating again, like at least 80% without any feed intolerance, you will shift the child to F100. And throughout this phase, you will be constantly monitoring the child for weight gain, for feed intolerance, any complications which we discussed. एंड साइंस सजेस्ट और एनी माइक्रोन्यूट्रिएंट डेफिशिएंसी. राइट, सो व्हेन डू यू, व्हेन वुड यू डिस्चार्ज? इफ यू हैव मॉनिटर्ड लाइक प्रोग्रेसिव, इफ द चाइल्ड कम्स आउट ऑफ दिस क्राइटेरिया, दैट इज नाउ द वेट फॉर हाइट इज नो लॉन्गर लेस देन 3 स्टैंडर्ड डेविएशन, नो कॉम्प्लिकेशंस, कंसिस्टेंट वेट गेन, एंड इफ यू आर कॉन्फिडेंट दैट मदर इज कॉन्फिडेंट नाउ टू टेक केयर ऑफ द चाइल्ड, एंड इफ यू हैव एंश्योर्ड एडिक्वेट फॉलोअप, देर इज नो, देर शुड नो, शुड नॉट बी एनी विजिबल एडिमा. So if all these criteria are being fulfilled, you will discharge the child, and this is not the end of the management. As you have already seen, the rehabilitation phase is going till 6 weeks. So for proper management of a SAM child, it requires at least 6 weeks, right? So this finishes everything about SAM, that is severe acute malnutrition, micronutrient deficiencies. We'll start with vitamin A. Vitamin A along with vitamin D has been considered to be a very important molecule in different signaling pathways. Some of the people now even start labeling them as endocrine hormones rather than pure vitamins. Active form of vitamin A is retinal, which is aldehyde, and retinoic acid. And a third one is retinol, which is an alcohol. Retinol is aldehyde and retinoic acid, which is a acid, carboxylic acid. So this retinoic acid is very important in reproductive function. And this retinol is very important in vision. So we all know that vitamin A deficiency leads to night blindness. So it is not only night blindness, but it is a spectrum of changes which affects the eye. And WHO divides this eye signs in two stages or in two parts, primary and secondary. So in primary, stage post is X1A, which means conjunctival xerosis. Xerosis means dryness. So that's the earliest sign, conjunctival xerosis. That is drying of conjunctiva. It is followed by X1B, which is bitot spot. So it is easy to remember, B stands for B. Bitot spots are yellowish flaky kind of deposits situated on the medial aspect of sclera. Then it leads to stage X2. So as soon as cornea gets involved, it becomes stage 2. So corneal xerosis is seen in stage 2. That is dryness. If it progresses to ulceration, it becomes stage X3, which is further divided into X3A and X3B. Corneal ulceration, also known as keratomalacia. If it is limited to less than 1/3 of cornea, it is called X3A. If it becomes greater than 1/3, it becomes stage X3B. Now there are secondary signs. Secondary sign includes XN called as night blindness, XF it means fundal changes, and the most extreme one XS means corneal scarring. Right? Now the treatment. Treatment of vitamin D deficiency is given is done as day 0, day 1, and day 40. Some of the books says day 28. It's more or less the same thing. It doesn't matter. It both of the regimens have been found to be equally efficacious. So if the dose would be 50,000, if the child 50,000 international unit, if the child is less than 6 months, 1 lakh international units, if the child is between 6 to 12 months, and dose is 2 lakh international units if the child is greater than 12 months. Now there is another catch. Sometimes children are very malnourished, so there is another criteria of weight. So minimum weight for giving 2 lakh international unit is 8 kilos. So let's say if the child is 15 month old, but if weight is 7.5, we will still give 1 lakh international unit. Very important. So less than 8 kg, irrespective of the age, will receive 1 lakh international unit. 2 lakh international unit, either age is 12 months at least, or child weight is above 8 kg. So these doses is given on day 0, day 1, and then day 40. So this is about vitamin A. Now vitamin D. I already told you it is also considered to be as an intracellular signaling molecule, and some of the people have already started appreciating its hormonal abilities, and its role is increasingly becoming more and more important, as it has been discovered that it is the part of the many signaling pathways affecting many other functions. So nowadays it's a hot topic of research. You will see a lot of articles mentioning role of vitamin D in almost everything. So we need to understand first the metabolism of vitamin D, how it is getting metabolized, how it is getting generated inside the body. So we all know it is a vitamin which can be generated from sunlight, and it's a time tested thing. Even our grandparents used to do that whenever a young infant or newborn is there, they always take them and expose them to the sunlight, and they always say it is good for the bones, and they were absolutely right, because sunlight is inducing vitamin D synthesis, and that's the physiological basis of exposing young infants and neonates to sunlight, because it boosts the production of vitamin D. So in skin, there is the raw form precursor cholecalciferol. So this is in skin. Then in liver, it becomes 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, and the enzyme is 25 alpha hydroxylase. This is happening in liver. Now in kidney, this 25 hydroxy cholecalciferol will get converted into 125 dihydroxy cholecalciferol, which is the active form of vitamin D, and the enzyme is 1-alpha-hydroxylase. Right? So this is how vitamin D is synthesized in the body. So what does vitamin D deficiency leads to? So vitamin D acts on basically three vital organs. Bone, intestine, and kidneys, and that's how it regulates calcium metabolism, And that's how it is very important for bone growth and mineralization. So there are other hormones also which helps in regulating calcium metabolism, and the other hormone is PTH, that is parathyroid hormone. So parathyroid hormone and vitamin D makes a helps in establishing a homeostasis as far as calcium metabolism is concerned. And these are the three sites where vitamin D acts: bone, intestine, and kidney. So what happens when vitamin D is deficient? It will lead to rickets, one of the most frequently asked topic in nutrition. Very, very important. And again, as an MBBS student, it is a favorite topic of examiner in theory as well as practical examination. They expect you to know each and everything related to rickets, right? Starting right from the vitamin D metabolism, its deficiency, its features, complication, and management. So we'll be discussing all those things one by one. So rickets, by definition, is lack of adequate mineralization, and there is a key word here, mineralization. And I already told you vitamin D is important for bone growth and mineralization. So rickets is primarily defect of lack of adequate mineralization of growing bones. This is very important word, growing bones, right? So if the bone becomes mature, like in adult, its counterpart, it known as osteomalacia. Very important. So osteomalacia, when the bones has stopped growing, it is called osteomalacia. And if it is affecting the growing bones, then it is called rickets. Right? So cause of rickets, it can be either because of calcium deficiency or phosphate deficiency. So phosphate deficiency rickets is called hypophosphatemic. Hypophosphatemic rickets. And this is called hypocalcemic rickets. Right? So this hypocalcemic rickets, what it will usually, it is associated with decreased vitamin D most of the time. And it will lead to increase in PTH. As I already told you, there is a fine balance between vitamin D and PTH, and both of the hormones, they act in conjunction with each other to regulate calcium metabolism in our body. So if vitamin D level is decreased, it will increase the PTH, and PTH will further promote calcium reabsorption and will try to restore the balance, right? So what are the clinical features now? Clinical features can try to remember from head to toe, and it's the most easiest way of remembering signs and symptoms of any clinical disorder or syndrome. Craniotabes, like ping pong type of skull. So it is easily depressed if you press it. Can be easily demonstrated in the occipital region. And it is the earliest sign. Very important. And we already learned wide and prolonged anterior fontanelle. Wide and prolonged means open. Anterior fontanelle. So even after 18 months of age, anterior fontanelle will be still there, and it is widely open. Right? Then gross motor milestones delay. Rickets children will be normal otherwise, like in their fine motor movements and their social and language, but because of defect in bone mineralization, they will present with delay in walking. So gross motor milestones will be affected. right? We already learned that rickets is the most common cause of delayed dentition after idiopathic. And when do we label delayed dentition? If there are no primary teeth by 13 months of life, then we label it as delayed dentition, right? Then rickettic rosary. So what is rickettic rosary? This is prominent costochondral junctions. Very important sign, costochondral junctions. Now, one interesting point is rosary is also seen in scurvy, which is because of vitamin C deficiency. Now, how to differentiate whether this rosary is because of vitamin C deficiency or vitamin D deficiency? First of all, scurvy is extremely rare nowadays. So, most likely it is vitamin D deficiency induced rosary, that is, it is rickettic rosary. Second, very important objective difference is this rosary is non-tender in rickets and it is tender in scurvy. Scurvy is also known as Sailor's disease because it has first described in sailors who are consuming seafood for a very long time and hence they become vitamin C deficient. So that is why it is called Sailor disease. Okay, now continuing the clinical features, Harrison sulcus or groove. So it is basically because of the marking of diaphragm on weakened bones. So diaphragm is basically is important in respiration. So it has attachment onto the costochondral junctions also, and it leads to a horizontal depression along the subcostal region, giving rise to a deep sulcus called a Harrison sulcus. Next would be wrist widening associated with frontal bossing. The wrists are widened and there is frontal bossing. Then protuberant belly. Protuberant belly, also called spots belly. Bowing of legs. Another very important thing to be noted here, bowing of the legs will start only when the child starts standing or walking. Even if the child is having severe vitamin deficiency and if he has not started walking, you won't be able to appreciate bowing. So bowing will start when the child will start bearing weight on the legs. Only then you will appreciate bowing. So bowing of the legs, also known as genu varum. So it is characteristically seen in toddlers. On the other hand, in older children, it will give rise to knock knees. That is genu valgus. So varus and valgus is a term which is used in relation to the joint. So if it is moving away from the axis, then it is valgus. If it is moving towards the body axis, then it is varus. So bowing of the legs means this is what is happening, right? And knock knees, imagine if these my elbows are knee, then it will become knock like this and the legs will be pointing away from the axis. So this is genu valgus and this is genu varum. Double malleoli, and they have increased tendency for fractures. Important because mineralization is defective, so bone get fractured easily, and mainly the green stick kind of fractures are most common. These are all clinical signs and symptoms of rickets. Now coming on to the radiological signs, which are very important again. So Because it's a defect of mineralization, the most common site of the bone which gets affected is metaphysis. Because this is a site of active mineralization. So signs will be which are appearing first will be loss of normal zone of calcification, loss of normal zone of provisional calcification will be the first sign. Then comes the fraying, and then fraying and cupping, and then comes flaying. So this is a sequence which is happening. So fraying basically is nothing but it is the widening of the growth plate. And let us see a radiological X-ray, and then you will be easily able to appreciate what is widening, what is fraying, what is cupping, and what is flaying. So this is the X-ray depicting classical signs of rickets. So as you can clearly see, this increasing concavity, this is what we call cupping, and this brush paint like appearance is called fraying, and this widening of metaphysis here is called flaying. Right? Now we'll move on to the biochemical markers. Or lab markers in rickets. Since it is primarily a disease of mineralization, the nutrients or the biochemical markers which will get affected are calcium and phosphate. And since bone lining also contains alkaline phosphatase, these three are the ones which will get disturbed most. And in conjunction with the radiological sign, these biochemical markers and clinical features will establish the diagnosis of rickets. Now, rickets can be because of any, it's not only the nutritional, but in our country, it is the most common cause. That is vitamin D deficiency because of lack of nutrition. But there are other causes of rickets also, like malabsorption, chronic renal failure, and vitamin D deficient resistant rickets also. So we'll be talking and discussing about those causes later on. But for the sake of simplification, if there is rickets, you will assume that it is nutritional rickets, right? So calcium will be low, phosphate will be normal to low, and ALP will be very, very high in case of rickets. Now, the best way to establish a diagnosis would be just measure the vitamin D levels. If vitamin D levels are low, then it is by default rickets. But unfortunately, vitamin D testing is not available in most of the government institutions. So we have to indirectly rely on the radiological findings and calcium, phosphate, and ALP ratios. Now, management. Now you have established, okay, this is rickets, all the classical signs are there. You have established the biochemical markers are going in favor of rickets. X-ray list is also showing cupping, fraying, and spleen. Then you will treat it as nutritional rickets. So management would be 6 lakh international units of vitamin D IM stat. If the child is greater than 1 year. If it is less than 1 year, you can give 3 lakh international units, same stat, followed by maintenance dose, which would be 400 international units per day, along with calcium supplementation. Dose would be 50 to 75 milligram per kg. So that's how you manage rickets. Then you ask the patient to come in follow-up. Ask the patient for follow-up at 6 weeks. So if it is simple nutritional rickets, follow-up visit at 6 weeks, you will get another X-ray done, and it will show zone of calcification, which is called white line of Frankel. Very important. Also called as healing line, as it is indicating healing. Now, there is another regimen which is more popular nowadays and it is much safer, is oral vitamin D supplementation. Not only for maintenance but therapeutic. Now, what's the problem in giving this injectable vitamin D? In our setting, most of the children, the compliance will be very poor. Let's say they have gone to one hospital, some clinician there recognized, okay, this child is having vitamin D deficiency. He advised vitamin D injections and child went away. Now he will go to the same other hospital. Most of the time they don't bring papers also. Now the other physician will realize, okay, the same thing is there, and he will advise another mega dose of 6 lakh international units. And sometime it can lead to hypervitaminosis D. Right? And it can give rise to pseudo tumor cerebri, which is also called as benign intracranial hypertension. So to avoid that, nowadays what we have started is we have started giving 60,000 international units in the form of oral sachets for 10 weeks. So 60,000 into 10, it will become 6 lakh. Now you are giving the same amount but over 10 weeks instead of giving one mega dose. So it is much safer and it prevents the potential complication of hypervitaminosis. Some of the there is another school of thought. So instead of giving weekly, they give every alternate day. But this one, every weekly, is the most widely used and most acceptable one. If it is nutritional rickets, in this follow-up visit you will see clearly white line of healing. But what if there is no healing? So then you will start thinking about refractory rickets. Then it is clear that, okay, it is not simple nutritional rickets. Like I was telling you earlier, that rickets can not only be because of nutritional deficiency, there are other secondary causes also. So this is called refractory rickets. Let's say you have given one mega dose. You have asked the patient to come for follow-up. There is no calcification. You have given another mega dose. That is 6 lakh international units. Now you have called the patient for another follow-up. There is still no calcification. This is the point when you will label it as refractory rickets. Very important. So even after giving 2 mega dosages of 6 lakh international unit, if the clinical signs and symptoms are still persisting, we label it as refractory rickets. Now what to do next? Now you have established that this is refractory rickets. So next step would be focus on serum phosphate levels. Right? If serum phosphate is high, it indicates CKD, chronic kidney disease. इफ सीरम फॉस्फेट इज नॉर्मल और इट इज लो, देन द नेक्स्ट स्टेप वुड बी मेजर द ब्लड पीएच. इफ देर इज एसिडोसिस, दैट इज इफ पीएच इज लो, इट मीन्स यू आर डीलिंग विथ रीनल ट्यूबुलर एसिडोसिस. इफ ब्लड पीएच इज नॉर्मल, देन यू हैव टू मेजर नेक्स्ट स्टेप सीरम पीटीएच लेवल्स एंड कंपेयर विथ कैल्शियम लेवल्स. नाउ इफ द पीटीएच लेवल्स आर इंक्रीज, राइट, एंड कैल्शियम लेवल इज डिक्रीज, इट मीन्स इट इज विटामिन डी डेफिशिएंसी रिकेट्स. इफ पीटीएच इज ऑल्सो नॉर्मल एंड कैल्शियम इज ऑल्सो नॉर्मल, देन यू आर डीलिंग विथ हाइपोफोस्फेटेमिक रिकेट्स. एंड इन हाइपोफोस्फेटेमिक रिकेट्स यू विल सी एलोपेशिया इज अ वेरी कॉमन एसोसिएटेड सिम्टम. दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, राइट. सो दिस इज द एल्गोरिदम. Measure serum phosphate level first. If it is high, it is CKD. If it is low or normal, see the blood pH. If there is acidosis, it is renal tubular acidosis. If there is no acidosis, measure the serum PTH and calcium levels. If PTH levels are increased, it is vitamin D deficiency rickets. And if the PTH levels are normal along with normal calcium levels, it means you are dealing with hypophosphatemic rickets, which is very commonly associated with alopecia. Now briefly about vitamin D resistant rickets. Sorry, it is vitamin D dependent, not deficiency. Vitamin D dependent resistance. So vitamin D dependent resistance, VDDR, right? So this is also associated with ectodermal defects and alopecia is also there. So it is divided into two types, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is because of 25 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. Remember, this is the enzyme which is responsible for hydroxylation in liver. When go back to your vitamin D metabolism, cholecalciferol in skin was getting converted into 25 alpha hydroxycalciferol, and this step was happening in liver. So in this there is deficiency of this enzyme, so vitamin D won't be able to convert into its active form, which is 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol. So in type 2, what is happening, enzyme is there, so it is active vitamin D is getting formed, but there is end organ resistance, right? So treatment would be the high doses of cholecalciferol available as calcitriol to overcome this block in the pathway, right? But they are very difficult to treat, and sometimes you have to give repeated mega dosages of vitamin D also in conjunction of calcitriol. Now briefly about RTA. So in RTA, that is renal tubular acidosis, what is happening? Phosphate is normal with acidosis and rickets is refractory. So renal tubular acidosis basically is divided into four types, but clinical importance is mainly of type 1 and type 2. So we'll be discussing only type 1 and type 2 here. So type 1 is called 1 because it was discovered first, though it is distal. So it is called type 1 just because it was discovered first. So ideally speaking, 2 is proximal, so proximal should be called as 1. But 1 and 2, this nomenclature is just on the basis of the fact that which disease was discovered first. So type 1 is distal and 2 is proximal. So There is basically in type 1, there is defect in H plus ion secretion. So in distal tubules of kidney, there are different kind of transporters which secretes H plus ion in tubules and makes the urine acidify. Because there is defect in H plus secretion, the urine pH never goes below 5.5, which is very, very important differentiating feature between type 1 and type 2 RTA. And this is the one which is mainly associated with rickets. Now in type 2 proximal, this H plus secretion is intact. So urine pH is greater than 5.5. Now type 2 is basically a part of Fanconi syndrome. Very important. If you remember your renal physiology, you probably might be knowing that proximal tubules are the site which are responsible for 70% of the reabsorption of majority of nutrients and chemicals. And since in type 2 there is defect in the proximal tubule, it will lead to loss of almost everything, including loss of sodium and mainly loss of bicarb. So bicarb, 70% is getting absorbed in the proximal tubules. And it is also the site of absorption of amino acids. So type 2 will lead to loss of amino acids in the urine also. So bicarb fractional excretion becomes greater than 50% in case of Fanconi syndrome, which is type 2 RTA, and loss of amino acids will lead to amino aciduria. So this is the basic difference between type 1 and type 2 renal tubular acidosis. Now third micronutrient will be iron. We all know it is very important for hemoglobin formation, and metabolism of hemoglobin is entirely dependent upon iron. So iron deficiency will give rise to anemia, and it is most common nutrient deficiency worldwide. This is important to remember, most common nutrient deficiency worldwide. And most common cause of deficiency again is nutritional, followed by hookworm infections. Followed by hookworm infections. Also, if the child is preterm, IUGR, the reserves are low. Plus, if there is any malabsorption, then again can be deficiency of iron. In case of chronic kidney disease, again, there can be secondary iron deficiency. But most of the time, it is nutritional or parasitic infections. So, clinical feature would be again pallor, hyperdynamic circulation. Sometimes, even if anemia is so severe, it can give rise to hemic murmur. And in extreme cases, it can give rise to congestive heart failure. Pallor you can see in eyes, that is in conjunctiva, palpable conjunctiva, and in palmar creases. Right? And in sometime in nails, you can see collyonychia. Important. It's called spoon-shaped nails, which is again an indirect indicator of severe iron deficiency. Right? So WHO classifies anemia on the basis of different age group. So if the child is less than 6 years, the cutoff is 11 gram percent. Between 6 to 12 years, it is 11.5 gram percent. And for greater than 12 years, it is 12 gram percent. So it is easy to remember. For 12, it is 12. For 6 to 12, just subtract 0.5, and for less than 6 years, it is 11 gram per cent. Although it varies according to the gender also, but for the sake of simplification, if you remember this value, it will grossly divide, classify the degree of anemia. Management, iron supplementation. So dose is 3 to 6 milligram per kg. So we always usually start with the lower dose first, You have to counsel the parents that, you know, sometimes there are different kind of iron preparations available in the market. So it might be possible that child might not be able to tolerate one preparation and he might easily tolerate the other one. You just tell them that child can be having dark color stools. It doesn't mean that the child is having melena. It is a very common side effect of iron supplementation, right? And peripheral smear will of course show microcytic hypochromic anemia. And gradually, as you will start supplementing, you always have to provide the dietary counseling along with that. Then you repeat the peripheral smear again after 4 to 6 weeks to see the response. In India and in most of the developing countries, mixed deficiency is very common. So they have iron as well as folic acid deficiency. So sometimes peripheral smear will suggest dimorphic anemia. That is both hypochromic, microcytic hypochromic as well as macrocytic. So this is called dimorphic anemia. So if that is the case, also add vitamin B12 and folic acid in cases of dimorphic anemia along with iron. Right? Lastly, zinc deficiency. Now, zinc again is a part of a variety of metalloenzymes. So it's an essential cofactor. Cofactor of lot of intracellular hormone regulating pathways, right? So that's why it indirectly affects cellular growth, nucleic acid metabolism, because it's a part of the DNA also, and it also regulate protein synthesis, right? So it is really, really crucial for our body. So its deficiency can give rise to growth retardation, mental retardation, hypogonadism, anorexia, alopecia, infections, diarrhea, anemia, and behavioral changes. And there is a very severe form of zinc deficiency leading to severe cutaneous manifestations, and it is called acrodermatitis enteropathica. Very important, has been asked many times. So it happens because of severe zinc deficiency. And it is a diffuse, basically it is associated with a desquamating skin rash. And sometimes it can be genetic, that is autosomal recessive pattern, right? And sometimes secondary zinc deficiency can happen in acute gastroenteritis. So we always supplement all the cases of acute gastroenteritis with zinc for 14 days. Similarly, sometimes secondary vitamin A deficiency is associated with measles. So we always give vitamin A supplementation if the child is having measles. Very important. Now, as you have clearly seen that it is the part of so many functions, that's why what happens whenever there is acute gastroenteritis, there is shedding of the intestinal epithelium, and zinc helps in regenerating that intestinal epithelium. Zinc doesn't prevent diarrhea itself, but it will promote the healing of intestinal mucosa. And that is why we give zinc supplementation for 14 days in all cases of acute gastroenteritis. So this finishes nutrition here. Thank you.
Thank you.